Katia, was again, thank you also for organizing this seminar series. It's a great service to the community. And I am going to give another nostalgic talk due to the past mainly and the last, what has happened in two inverse problems in the last 20 years or so. So these are geometric inverse problems. You take a Riemannian manifold with boundary. You are not familiar with Riemannian geometry. You just think about the symmetric positive definite matrix. And the question is, the general question is, can you recover the geometry and the topology by making measurements at the boundary? This arises in many situations. Well, I'm going to make emphasis on the geometry, so that means recovering the metric itself. And I'm going to consider two types of measurements, the boundary distance function between points on the boundary and the scattering relation, which corresponds to the travel time, how much time does it take for waves to go from one point to the other of the boundary, different type of waves. And the other one is the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, as the title of the talk suggests. This is arises from the Laplace-Beltrami operator and is in dimension three or larger, is related to Calderon problem, electrical impedance tomography, when you make electrical measurements at the boundary. So there are two types of measurements in dimension three, say, travel time measurements and electrical measurements, voltage and current measurements at the boundary. So let me start with the first problem. Some of you have heard this talk, I apologize, but my main interest in this talk is to emphasize a couple of open problems and that, you know, that are very difficult, apparently difficult and require a new idea. So especially the young people in the audience might think about them. So this travel time arose in global seismology to determine the inner structure of the Earth by measuring the travel times of seismic waves. So, of course, here you have a cartoon of seismic waves. There is compressional waves that are faster, and the shear waves that go faster and penetrate deeply into the Earth. So we record the travel times in seismic stations around the Earth. And I will mention a theorem that is in nature was hype as a long-awaited mathematics proof could help scan Earth inners. I hope that's true. And of course, seismic waves and earthquakes are the type of information that we know. And on the other one is underground nuclear explosions. And unfortunately, my home country, my native country, Chile, has the record of the largest earthquake ever recorded. It was 9.5 in the Richter scale. You can see here, it was in the city of Valdivia near in the south of Chile in 1960. And it produced a huge tsunami that went through the Pacific, producing earthquakes in the region, especially in Japan. In a different scale and different frequencies, this arises in ultrasound transmission tomography. So you have a transmitter and receiver of sound waves. Now I have drawn here the curves perpendicular to the wave fronts. This will be geodesics of sound metric, but that depends, that the path of propagation depends on the sound speed or the index of refraction of the medium. So they are not straight lines like X-rays, but the curve. And so the travel time in the what we are going to call the isotropic case is the superposition of the infinitesimal travel times. C is the sound speed. integrated over this curve gamma, and that's the travel time, and you move the receiver around and the transmitter around. Of course, also you have other types of tomography. I will briefly talk about reflection tomography. When you have singularities in a medium, the waves reflect. That happens in oil exploration, for instance. And we're going to measure the travel time of once broken rays, this curves here. And the obstacle problem includes both the transmission of waves and the reflection of waves. Because reflection arises in both geophysics and medical imaging. In geophysics, in finding oil, you have a ship with a long tail that has Gunther sounds, and this the travel time or information on the waves is recorded in the same tail in hydrophones, and you want to recover the substructure under the sea. So most of the oil exploration is done in the sea. And for high frequency waves, different scale again, different frequency. This is done routinely now in pregnant women, you know, send sound waves and measure the echo, the reflection. So to set up the problem and the motivation, so was that the motivation was to determine the inner structure of the Earth by measuring the travel times of seismic waves. And this problem was considered very early on in 1805 by mathematician Hercules and later by this geophysicist Wicker and Soffliets. This was even before the radon transform. So the assumption was that the Earth was spherically symmetric. You have a spherically symmetric medium with a sound speed depending only on the radius. And this strange condition, it looks strange, but that just says that the sound speed increases with the radius as depth decreases. So this is the time in that case along these curves. Again, these curves are perpendicular to the wavefronts. And what are these curves? So this is determined by the Rayleigh theory of light based on Fermat's principle. You try to go from one point to the other in the minimum amount of time possible, but the time depends on the index of refraction. And here on the right, you have the picture of the index of refraction very low and increases. So to have minimum amount of time, or what's called the shortest optical path, you have to curve. The rays have to curve. And it's not anymore the straight line, the shortest path. And this happens in very hot surfaces, in the desert, for instance, that index of refraction, so the rays curve, and this Rayleigh theory of light or sound explains why you see a mirage, because you're seeing the sky, you think you're seeing water, but you're seeing the sky. So to set up the problem in the case of Herglocks, the sound speed depends only on the radius, and the length is given. The length is given in terms of the inverse of the sound speed. So this is what's called conformal to the Euclidean metric. Dx squared is the standard metric, so you deform it. So the larger the sound speed, the smaller the length. And more generally, we want to consider an inhomogeneous medium. This assumption that the speed depends only on the radius is very restrictive. And in this case, the velocity is C of X is independent of direction, as called the isotropic case. However, many mediums are anisotropic. Muscle tissue is anisotropic in the human body. And even the inner core of the Earth has been shown to be anisotropic with the fastest direction of propagation, the direction of the axis of rotation of the Earth. So this is represented by what's called a general Riemannian metric. But you can think of a positive definite symmetric matrix. And the velocity in this case depends on direction. G upper I j is the inverse of the metric g. So again, it's the inverse square root, like in the isotropic case. And the information on travel time, the first information we're going to consider is the first arrival times of waves. And that's encoded in what's called the boundary distance function. And it's convenient, and it's actually, it simplifies the problem in many ways, is to consider it as a geometric problem. So a compact Riemannian manifold with boundary. Again, you can think of a domain with a positive definite symmetric matrix, and the distance function, a basic object in differential geometry, in Riemannian geometry, is just the infimum of sufficiently regular curves joined in the points x and y. And the length of the curves in coordinates is given by the superposition of the infinitesimal lengths of the curves, which is given here. And the inverse problem is very simple to state. Can you recover the metric g knowing the distance function for every two boundary points? And this is called the boundary rigidity problem in geophysics, in differential geometry. It has been around in geophysics quite a long time. And the answer is no, but any geometry will tell you that you have an isometry preserving length. This is not going to be the case. But so in particular, if you have a diffeomorphism, which is identity at the boundary, so the points x and y are fixed, what's called the pullback of the metric is the same. The distance is the same as the distance of the metric g. So there is a large group of non-uniqueness. This is an infinite dimensional group. And in terms of matrices, the pullback is simply the composition of the Jacobian, the metric, and the transpose. And this can be easily seen by taking the definition of the length, and then you perturb your curve. The points x and y are unchanged by the change of variables, and then you do apply the chain rule, and you get that the pullback has the same length. But unfortunately, that's not the only non-uniqueness. If you have a point which has a very low velocity, very high metric, the metric is very large at the point x0, so large that this is bigger than the supremum of all the distances between boundary points. To minimize length, you're not going to go through the point x0, you're going to avoid it, so you cannot say anything about the point x0. And here in the case of the southern hemisphere, I come from Chile in the southern hemisphere, I like to put the south pole up. You can increase the metric a little bit near the south pole, and then you are not going to go to minimize length, you're not going to go around the south pole, but you're going to go along the equator. So to make this definition, a manifold is boundary rigid, you have another metric. Remember, the metrics are velocities. If there is a diffeomorphism, which is the identity of the boundary, so one is the pullback of the other, and what we need is some a priori information for the manifold to be boundary rigid, and it's not clear what is a necessary and sufficient condition. Okay, there are sufficient conditions as we are going to explain, but that's an open problem and maybe would never be solved. So one condition is simplicity. And this is defined if given two points on the boundary, there is six, the unique minimizing geodesic joining the points x and y, and the boundary is strictly convex with respect to the metric. For instance, in this case, the speed is increasing and the geodesic curve here. This is a strictly convex. Given two points on the boundary, the geodesic joining them are inside. And the conjecture is that if the manifold is simple, then it's boundary rigid. This has been posed by René Michel, but it's not so clear who actually proposed it first. But at least goes back to that point. And the Herglos condition that was mentioned earlier, and it's not the same as simplicity. These are very nice examples constructed by François Monard. You take your geodesic starting at the point zero here for these Gaussians that satisfy the Herglos condition. In this case of 4K, the geodesics behave very well. In the 4K 0.49, the geodesics curve, like it happens in positive curvature, and this you have what's called a caustic or a conjugate point at the boundary. And here the caustic or the conjugate point when geodesics come together happens in the interior for this value of K, 1.23. Okay, in the isotropic case, and I'm going to talk about simplicity for the moment. There is a very nice result of Mohometov in 1977 that introduced a new method, the energy method, to show this result. So you take a conformal multiple of a metric, so multiple beta, which is positive. One case, the important case is the case we have considered already, the isotropic case is the inverse of the sound speed square. Then there is no diffeomorphism invariance because you pull back a conformal metric, suppose you take the 1 over c squared times identity, is not going to be isotropic anymore. So there is possibility of uniqueness, and this has been proven by Mohometov, starting in two dimensions and then generalized by many authors. I'm not going to give the dates. So, and also, he also proved stability. So these are close, the distance are close, then beta is close to one. And this is the assumption is simplicity. So this is the isotropic case. How about the anisotropic case? Michel proved compact subdomains of Euclidean space or the parabolic plane or the open round hemisphere that has to be the open. Otherwise, it's, we already saw, it's not boundary rigid. They are boundary rigid. Gromov generalized Michel's result that compact domains of Euclidean space for any dimension. Besson, a consequence of Besson, Courtois, and Galois result is that compact subdomains of negatively curved symmetric spaces are boundary rigid. But all these examples have constant curvature special symmetries. We started the case of where we have no constant curvature of symmetries with Plum and Stefano, where two metrics are close to the Euclidean metric. This was generalized with Matti Lassas and Vladimir Sharafutdinov when only one metric is close to the Euclidean metric, and Burago and Ivanov consider the same, but how small is the metric to the Euclidean metric is a universal constant. Here we have to assume conditions on the curvature. In two dimensions, more is known. Atoll and Krog prove boundary rigidity for the Gaussian curvature is negative. Here the behavior of the geodesics is very nice, certainly simple. And this conjecture was solved by Pesto and myself in two dimensions. So two-dimensional Riemannian manifold with boundary, which are simple, are boundary rigid. So from the distance function, you can recover the metric up to the diffeomorphism invariance. So with Plum in dimensions three or larger, we prove a local result, local generic result with Plum and Stefanov. There is a generic set, so open and then set of metrics and CK of M for K sufficiently large. If they are close to these ones, for instance, analytic metrics, then there is rigidity. So the distance function recovers the metric up to the diffeomorphism. Also, we prove Hölder stability estimates. So again, this set contains all the real analytic metrics. Okay, but all those results are nice. However, you have this assumption of simplicity, which is no conjugate points. And this is not satisfied in practice. In many situations, you have caustics or conjugate points, focal points, etc. So one should be looking at the behavior of all the geodesics. So for that, we go to phase space. We consider geodesics in phase space, a point, given a point in the direction that is unique geodesic, going to that point in that direction. So you take this, the Hamiltonian, which is normalized so that Hg is equal to zero corresponds to the unit sphere with respect to the metric G. And you take what's called the bicharacteristic curve. So now we're in phase space, which is solutions of this Hamiltonian system. So you differentiate the Hamiltonian with respect to C minus d dx, and this gives you the curves in phase space, starting in the sphere, and they stay in the sphere. So this is the curves stay in Hg is equal to zero. This vector field is tangent to Hg equal to zero. And geodesics are simply the projections in X of this bicharacteristic curves. It's also called null bicharacteristic because you are on the surface Hg equal to zero. So this is a nice way of looking at geodesics. It's a Hamilton way, and is relates it to symplectic geometry and many things. So the geodesics minimize lengths locally. So this is the time locally. However, they don't minimize lengths globally. You have caustics. And this is an example when you have a slow region in the center that corresponds to the center of the Earth. So one needs to look at the behavior of all the geodesics in some sense to be able to recover the metric without this no conjugate assumption. And one way to encode that is what's called the scattering relation. You take a point and a direction, you follow the geodesic, assume it's non-trapping, and you map it to the point of exit and direction of exit. This came as the scattering relation was defined by Guillemin, and it came as the wavefront set is of the scattering operator arises from there. And the conjecture, and this is a problem, this is the first problem I would like to propose here to the, as I said, especially to the young people to think about. It's a nice geometric problem. Suppose it's non-trapping, although you may assume some trapping like Guillermo has assumed hyperbolic trapping. Then from the scattering relation, you can recover the metric up to, of course, there is always the diffeomorphism invariance. An indication of that, and this is an open problem in general. I'm going to mention some results about this soon. The theorem of Pestovan myself solving the boundary rigidity problem in two dimensions that gives a connection between the scattering relation and the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. And I want to explain a little bit more later this connection. So one should really be looking at the scattering relation, because if you solve that problem, you solve the boundary rigidity problem as well. Because in the case that the manifold is simple, it's easy to see that the scattering relation and the distance function gives you the same information. There is no new information in the scattering relation. There is a unique geodesic. So the direction of exit, and you can just get it by differentiating the distance function and the direction of entrance as well. So this is the right problem to consider, the scattering relation, whether the scattering relation determines the metric. We have other, if to get some results, and this is, as I said, is wide open. There are results in the lens rigidity problem, where, and besides the scattering relation, you assume the length of the geodesic or the travel time, which may be, if there is trapping, may be infinite. And again, the diffeomorphisms preserving the boundary do not change this length data. The length data corresponds to the scattering relation and the length of the geodesic. It's not clear at all. If you solve the previous conjecture, of course, you don't need these lengths, whether the lengths can be determined by the scattering relation or not. This is another question, whether this is redundant information. If there is a lot of trapping, there are counterexamples due to Crook and Kleiner. And so the lens rigidity problem and the boundary rigidity problem are equivalent for simple metrics. So this is, as I want to emphasize again, and so I want to emphasize that this is the right problem to consider. There has been several results for non-simple metrics. When you have caustics, this is a more important assumption, or non-convex boundary, which is also another restriction. And lens rigidity is the right problem to study. And there are several results. I'm sorry if I didn't mention your favorite result here. There are several such results. And I'm going to concentrate on the last one. Since I want to talk about the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, I don't give you all the results here. I want to very quickly talk about the last one with Stefano Hambachi, which just published this year, although it was in the archives 4 years ago. So, and this is in dimension 3 or larger, you can have a compact Riemann manifold with strictly convex boundary, and that there is a strictly convex function with f equal to 0 the boundary, and you take another Riemannian metric, assuming that the boundary is strictly convex with respect to that metric as well. But you don't assume the assumption of strictly convex for the other metric. If G and G tilde have the same length relation, then there exists a diffeomorphism that fixes the boundary so that one metric is a pullback of the other. An example of this is strictly convex manifolds on non-negative sectional curvature. This is surprising because in this case, there are caustics. And the condition in the case of radial speeds, the radial speed satisfying the Herglos condition, then you have to satisfy this assumption that there is a strictly convex function. So this is in some sense the natural generalization of the Herglos and Wicker and Soffrich condition. Also simply connecting manifold with non-positive sectional curvature. So the behavior of the geodesics is very nice in this case. Okay, in the reflection case, in the case that there are scattering points in the interior, and you have the information about all what's called the broken scattering relation. So once broken scattering relation. So you have a point here, meets another geodesic, and that starts at the point x1, c1, and you know the travel time plus these points. So this is, that's called the broken scattering relation. Then you can recover the manifold uniquely, of course, up to the diffeomorphism invariants. And of course, you have more information here, but this is a nice result because scattering points happen in many situations. You do have this information. And the geodesic transform, the other part of the title of my talk, is the linearization of the map. This is from the metric to the distance function in the same conformal class. You linearize that problem, which is a nonlinear problem, to recover beta from the distance function. Then you are led to the geodesic transform, which is the integration of a function along geodesics. This is the analog of the X-ray transform in the case that the geodesics are straight lines. And so this arises as a linearization of this problem. You linearize the full problem, you have here tensors, but I'm not considering the case, I'm not considering in this talk the case of tensors. Okay, so the other object in my, an important object in my talk is the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. So this is well known for this audience. This is in local coordinates, the Laplace-Beltrami operator, g upper j is the inverse again, modulus g is also the square root of the determinant of g. And you have the Dirichlet problem, and you take the normal derivative with respect to the metric, which in local coordinates is given in this formula. In the case of dimension bigger or equal than 3, this problem is equivalent to Calderon's problem of recovering the conductivity by making voltage and current measurements at the boundary. And the connection between conductivities and metrics is given here, is the square root determinant of g times g upper j. Okay, so this is the problem. And the question is, can we recover the metric G from the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, which are just information about on the boundary? And the voltage to current map is really just in the case of dimension 3 or larger. This is the inverse anisotropic problem, which is largely open. And another motivation comes from holography. Can we recover the bulk from the boundary distance function, which is measured on the boundary, or the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map? I should have put here the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. And these authors made that connection. So this is just information on the boundary. This, so the question is whether you can see the three-dimensional world in two dimensions. Everything, you can reflect it in the two-dimensional boundary. Okay, and this is also invariant under diffeomorphism. You take the pullback of the metric, then it's this a diffeomorphism, which is the identity at the boundary. It gives you the same Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. And this can be seen by looking at the quadratic form associated to the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. This is the power needed to maintain the potential F on the boundary in the case of dimension 3 or larger. And it's equivalent to the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, which is information just on the boundary. And then this is very similar to the computation we did for curves before. If you compose this U with the change of variables and you apply the chain rules, you will see that you will get the pullback here, and this is invariance. And the question is, this is the only invariance. In two dimensions, there is an additional invariance. So this is the question whether there is the only obstruction. I'm going to mention the results known, but this is largely open. In two dimensions, there is an additional obstruction. If you take a conformal multiple of the metric, so positive multiple of the metric, then it's very easy to calculate this, is you get 1 over beta times Laplace and g of u. So the two metrics, beta times g and g, have the same harmonic functions, equal to 0 for the same functions. Therefore, the Dirichlet-to-Neumann maps coincide with beta at the boundary is 1. And in dimension 2, these are the only obstructions. So the diffeomorphism invariance is always present in any dimension bigger or equal than 2. And in dimension 2, you have the conformal invariance. In dimension 2, it's completely solved. You take a connected Riemannian manifold with boundary and assume that the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, then it's true that there is a diffeomorphism and there is a function beta. so that one metric is a conformal multiple of the other. And in fact, you can recover the topology as well. You can recover the metric up to the natural invariance and the topology. In dimension three, unfortunately, I just mentioned one result here in the general case. This is a largely open problem in the C infinity case. There are some very nice counterexamples. These are counterexamples when you take non-smooth metrics by Dode, Kirwan, and Nicolau. But in the real analytic case, we know this result. And this was proven in the same paper with Matilassas, and there is a nicer proof that with Michael Taylor a couple of years later. And this is an open problem whether this is true, and this considered to be the most perhaps important problem from the theoretical point of view, whether this theorem is true for a smooth matrix, smooth enough matrix. And I will explain the connection in two dimensions between the scattering, between the distance function and the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. The theorem, as I recall briefly, is two-dimensional Riemannian manifold which boundary, which are simple, are boundary rigid. So you can recover the metric up to the natural abstraction. And the theorem uses really that in the simple case, the distance function is equivalent to the scattering relation. And it goes really from the scattering relation, which is the correct information, to the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. Remember, the scattering relation maps point of entrance and direction of entrance to point of exit and direction of exit. And so you prove if the distance functions are the same, which is a surprising result, then you can recover the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. If the distance functions are the same, the Dirichlet-to-Neumann maps are the same, and using the result with Matilassas, then you have in two dimensions, this uses simplicity in a way that we'll explain, that G1 is a conformal multiple of the other metric. And this is a pullback under diffeomorphism, which is the identity of the band. And then now you have that this should be G2 here, the distance G2 is equal to that. So beta is one by Mohammed's result. And then you have the result that G1 is the pullback of G2. This uses in a fundamental way that the geodesic transform, which I defined previously, integration of function along geodesics, is injective. Because in this, and this is true in the simple case, but it's true in other cases as well. But one of the main things that we use is that the adjoint is surjective. And for that, we need that the range in appropriate spaces of the geodesic transform is closed. And we use the simplicity here in a strong way to show that I star I is an elliptic pseudo-differential operator. And therefore, Fredholm, so you have that the range is closed. It's an elliptic differential operator in an open extension of the manifold. Okay, so to show that, so it's very likely that you can prove injectivity of the X-ray transform in the non-simple case, then you will be able to prove the more general result in two dimensions. In fact, Guillermo and so prove the same result in the case that the boundary is non-convex, but still you have no conjugate points. So there is a formal connections between the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, the two objects I have considered, the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map and the boundary distance function. you have a kernel for the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map that depends on two n minus two variables. Every operator, bounded operator, has a kernel. The distance function also depends on two n minus two variables, so there is no way to do asymptotics, semi-classical asymptotics. The number of variables is the same. The other connection is that the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map is in infinite dimension in some sense. You have this quadratic form here, and is and here the distance function was also obtained as the infimum of the length of some quadratic form. And that led to the invariance of the problem, is the fact that you have defined via these quadratic forms, the same for the distance function or the scattering relation, and the same for the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. So in some sense, her functions correspond to curves. So you have the infinite dimensional space on the left and the finite dimensional space on the right. And functions correspond to curves, and harmonic functions correspond to geodesics, very roughly speaking. So for the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, we have to solve a PDE. For the scattering relation, we are really solving a simple ODE in phase space. You take the Hamiltonian, you take these characteristic curves, we know the initial condition and we know the final condition. And also we know the time. Remember, we know the length of this geodesic. So it's an ODE problem in phase space. And on the left is a PDE problem. And the other connection is that this is the graph of the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. It's a Lagrangian manifold for the people who are familiar with this. In the case of metric is Euclidean, this is the symplectic form given in terms of Green's formula. This is just Green's formula, and the similar one is for the general metric. So this graph, when this is the normal derivative, vanishes by Green's formula. And if you take the projections of the directions on the tangent space, this is also a Lagrangian manifold but in finite dimensions. So there is a formal connection, and my conjecture is that in dimension bigger or equal to 3, that's a way to attack the problem, the anisotropic problem for the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. You can determine, knowing the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, the scattering relation, and the distance function, or maybe one of them. Maybe just under the condition that there is a strictly convex function on the manifold for simplicity. But if you can make that connection, we can apply all the results we know about the scattering relation and the distance function and obtain them for the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. We know very little in dimension 3 or higher about, in the general case, about the anisotropic problem for the general metric. So I encourage this is just a possibility to attack this problem. It's not the only one. One way to simplify the problem is to consider it in the same conformal class. So G tilde is a multiple of G, and this is reduced to a Schrödinger equation, but for the Laplace-Beltrami operator. And here is the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map. So the question is recovering the potential, which corresponds to recovering the conformal multiple. This reduction is quite easy to do. It's the same as the conductivity by taking the square root of beta times the solution. So the strategy is the same. So the Dirichlet-to-Neumann maps are the same. The products of solutions is orthogonal to the difference. And then we need to construct complex geometrical optic solution. This is one way, but this is the only way we really know how to do this. And then show that the products are dense. In the case of the Euclidean metric, this is was done in dimension 3. We're talking about just dimension three or higher. These are the complex geometrical optic solutions where rho is equal to zero. And you have a remainder term going to zero. And now in general, we take a more general phase here. And we take the semi-classical, it's very useful to take the semi-classical version by taking the frequency modulo rho as 1 over h, or h 1 over rho. So you consider the conjugate of the Laplacian, and you need to solve for this operator to be able to find complex geometrical optic solutions. So the theorem is that to solve for this with the right estimate, because you want the remainder to have to decay as h goes to zero. And we have the Kalman estimate, and this is the bracket condition that makes it very restrictive. The Poisson bracket between the conjugate of the principal symbol, the semi-classical principal symbol of this, yes, itself must be zero. So this is the general framework proposed in Koenig-Shostrom and myself and then in this other paper. And the case that they have been able to do is in the case with what's called conformally transversely isotropic manifolds. And these are the Kalman weights that had been taken, x1 and log modulo of x. So these are the conformally transversal isotropic manifolds. There is an Euclidean direction. So E is the Euclidean direction, and then in the transversal direction, you have in principle something arbitrary. Since I'm running out of time, I will go quickly on this. And the uniqueness holds in this case. We're using this, just the phi to be x1, the Euclidean direction. And the transversal, the case of the transversal manifold is simple, was done in this paper that I mentioned before. And this was weakened to just have the geodesic X-ray tantrum to be injected. But we need some conditions on the transversal manifold. This is another connection with the geodesic transform. And the final result, and I will be finishing with this, the recent result, we consider the case dimension three, but you know, it can be generalized to higher dimensions. Suppose you have a smooth, compactly supported potential. Now you have a frequency here. This arises in the scattering theory, inverse scattering at fixed energy. Suppose that this is not an eigenvalue. Then this is the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map again. And then the theorem we prove with Iran 1 is that if the sectional curvatures are non-positive, and we need this for the geodesic transform to be injected. It's likely to be generalized to simple manifolds or manifolds satisfying there exists a strictly convex function on the manifold. You take two potentials and you consider the corresponding Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, then if the Dirichlet-to-Neumann maps, then this is the same for large enough frequency. If lambda is large enough, we're able to do that. And then for this class of potentials, it's likely that we can obtain Hölder estimates, and reconstruction is also, the problem is reduced to inverting some geodesic transform with some weight. And the connection with the geodesic transform and the distance function is seen in the parametrics. You have to build the parametrics. And the parametrics can be built to the identity plus something that decays. Can be built in terms of the distance function. So you have a source point at y, this is the Schwarz kernel, and you're measuring at x. So the phase function is a distance function. That's why you will need simplicity or a condition like this so that this is smooth. And the U1 is obtained by integrating the potential along geodesics joining the point XY. So this is an approximation. That's why we need lambda to be large. And we obtain approximately the geodesic X-ray transform of Q, and then therefore Q approximately. And then by another argument, we can conclude that the potentials are the same. So this gives you, for large frequency, gives a connection of the Dirichlet-to-Neumann map at the fixed frequency with the distance function and the geodesic X-ray transform. And I'm sure there will be many other connections to be explored. And I finish with this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gunther, for the very interesting talk. Thank you very much. Are there any questions or comments, please? Please feel free to unmute yourself.
It was completely unclear.
Any questions or comments, please?
No questions, huh?
Okay, I have just one small question. I mean, do you think your last result can be extended to the case of magnetic Schrodinger operators?
Yes, I think so. There are several extensions of this. First, to the only, here I were considering the case of the potential. I'm pretty sure that this result, if this is true, then it implies that for lambda large enough again. Mm-hmm. Implies that the distance functions are the same. This is the nonlinear, not the conformal case. The other case is we only wrote it down in detail in dimension three, but it's likely to be true in dimension three or higher. And the other possibility, as you mentioned, extending it to other operators. But because in all those cases, this weighted geodesic transform is known in the magnetic case, and for instance, it's known. So I suspect that this is true. The main thing is to construct these parametrics in terms of geometric information.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Are there any other questions or comments, please?
Very interesting. So I have a question about generalization.
Which one?
Machine learning. You see, because it's very similar problem that appears in machine learning that, for example, when you learn manifolds from graphs, when you have Laplace Beltrami operator, basically you want just to know geodesics. Yes. Right. And you have your data, a diffusion, but not on Dirichlet-to-Neumann map, not on surface, but on scattering points. Scattered points. So you have green function, diffusion green function, scattered points, and it's very important problem. If anybody is looking at that, it's sort of related to what you showed.
Yes. That's a very interesting question. The fact that we're imposing Dirichlet-to-Neumann map is not really completely necessary. For instance, last result implies it's results about scattering, scattering of fixed energy. Which you're measuring at infinity. And I'm sure other kinds of measurements are possible. This is, but in every case, you obtain an identity, like I mentioned before, the difference of the potential is orthogonal. And that's the key step.
Yeah, in fact, they don't have potential. The potential is zero.
Right. Yeah, just a metric, just recovering the metric.
Yeah,
that's the basic problem. Yeah, that will be very interesting to do for graphs. Maybe we can talk about that.
Yeah, it would be interesting. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Are there any other questions or comments, please?
Yeah, hi, Gunther. Just a quick question on what you answered to Katya. Could you repeat the statement that you said you can show that Dirichlet-to-Neumann maps determine the metrics?
Yes.
For large lambda?
Yes. This is not written down. This is
right. Conjecture. Okay. So what's the statement?
The conjecture is that if for lambda sufficiently large, if the Dirichlet-to-Neumann maps for two metrics are the same, then the distance functions are the same, or the scattering relations are the same.
So no potentials there.
No potentials. Yeah.
But you said something same conformal class or not same conformal class?
If they are in the same conformal class, then it's reduced to the case of the potential.
I see.
Right. The same conformal class, there is no diffeomorphism invariant, making the problem easier.
Right.
However, the real problem is the metric problem, which is we have very little idea, at least in the continuous case, how to do it. One way to do it is to relate it to the distance function or the scattering relation. And I have been trying this, but you know, we need some young, bright minds for an idea on this.
Do you need a single large lambda, or do you mean?
A single large lambda.
Single.
But yes.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, we're going to explain the proof of the result, but there is absolutely no time. It will be in the slides, and the paper is on the archive.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Are there any other questions or comments, please?
I can see many old friends in the audience. I didn't have time to look at the audience, but I can see. Hi, Fadil.
Thank you. Okay, if there are no other questions, thank you very much, Gunther, for the very nice talk. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Katya, for inviting us, and for organizing this seminar series.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay.